Hi, welcome to this week's edition of Blues Talk. Again, John, Dave, and myself going to look back over Leinster's victory against the Ospreys last weekend. All the other Pro 12 games, look forward to our match against Italy in the Aviva Stadium. So, boys, 1916.
It was
the Ospreys, yeah. I saw Madigan's boots had a little tricolour on it.
A fine centenary score. Like all games against the Ospreys, I mean, it's always, to a certain extent, it's a bit like a game against Munster. It doesn't matter how you do it, as long as you come out on top. This year, a bit less so, because usually we're challenging with Ospreys up. Ospreys would be challenging much tighter for something. This year, not so much. So it's literally just 4 points won, as opposed to kind of an 8 point swing.
Yeah, it is. But if you look through the two team sheets, you would have expected Leinster to come out an awful lot better off than they did. I mean, on paper, that Ospreys team was a lot weaker, with the possible exception of Reece Webb, than our team. They got very few back from Wales. I think they only got two back. And they were missing a lot of their stars, whereas we had, we were also missing a lot of our stars, but we had, you know, I would argue anyway, a much better team than them on paper. So the fact that they stuck in with us and did, you know, they were nasty and mean and did all that kind of stuff, which it looks good for them and not so good for us. Having said that, they are now effectively out of Europe. I mean, they could win all their games and still end up in seventh. You know, it's had a bad effect. Like, it's had a good effect on us score-wise because we kept 3 points ahead of them. It's had a fairly serious effect on them because they've one game less than us. I think they've 5 games left, and even if they win them all, they're with bonus points, they might just about struggle into Europe without. They're gone. So, you know, onwards and upwards. But we'll need to be a lot better if we're going to be beating Glasgow. And
mixed game, though, wasn't it? Like, I mean,
it was.
There's some nice positives. I mean, like, for
Dan Levy's
try. One of probably the best tries that we've scored all season. Yeah. We worked it lovely. It was back to the old days.
And that turned the game because we were shit before it. Yeah. We were really shit.
We went, I think it was 16-3 up at half time, and then let them back into it. I mean,
did the usual thing, second half.
And, you know, we got a kick charge down, and I think McGrath had it. Which could have, you know, it's a bounce of a ball, a bounce of a rugby ball can go anywhere.
Yeah, could have been very costly. And if we'd have scored first in that second half, they would have been gone. They would have been, you know, we could have coasted through the rest of the game. But it was a very tense ending to the game. I mean, even if they'd have got a penalty and drawn the game, that would have been as good as a loss to us, you know.
It gave us yet another example to admire Leinster's defensive system.
Yeah.
I mean, the only way that they were going to score is how they did score, which was personal error. We'd say
Triggs.
Personal error. I mean, one could say that
you just made a mistake.
One could say, yeah, that's what I'm saying. They couldn't construct anything. Triggs make that tackle, there's no try. Now, one has to give credit to Dan Baker. I thought he put in a nice bit of footwork on Triggs. In fairness to him,
for a big man,
yeah, he put in. There was some nice dancing feet there. But I mean, that's what I'm saying. At its harshest level, and I'm sure that's how Leinster will review it, is that the only way that they were going to score was as a result of personal error. And which is what happened. Our defence is becoming
a weapon,
very, very intimidating, and it's intimidating other sides as well. You can see teams are a bit wary of trying to get round us, and they're not really able to.
It'll be very interesting if we get into the playoffs against Connacht, and the meanest defence and the best attack go up against each other. Wouldn't that be a Didn't something like that happen in the Super Bowl?
It's kind of one of the worst defences.
Well,
they do, but they've got by far the best attack. Mm. They've scored 49 tries, which is 11 more than us. Now, admittedly, they've played one more game, but
we should get 11 tries against Glasgow.
Well, they're a bit like Brazil in 1970, before your time, lads. And if you score 5, we'll score 6. So, you know, that's kind of the way they approach it.
Is that they might be like Brazil in 1982. who were probably a better team than 1970. They just had one minor problem.
Pele had retired.
Well, two minor problems. One, they had an absolute dinosaur up front, and the other was that they couldn't defend for peanuts. Mm. It'll be interesting, actually, because, I mean, we are the best defence, they are the best attack, so we'll see at Easter, actually, what it'll be like.
Be interesting.
But back to the game, I mean, there were elements that were good. The one element that was both good and bad in the match was Ben Teo.
Super.
It was good in that he was absolutely superb. The bad thing is he won't be superb for us next year.
That's true. He's he's been coming on as a player, and I suppose Worcester are going to reap the benefits of that, but they're paying a lot of money to be reaping them, so you know, hey. I don't know if Leinster could afford to give him that kind of money next year.
But like, I mean,
and let's face it, we've got a good replacement.
Well, we've said it before, like the whole point of having Leinster is to have Irish players playing for them, and if you're going to have an Irish international centre taking his place, it's not a bad place. Absolutely. It's not like we're getting a donkey from, you know, an NPC.
No, we're getting a good player in. I mean, when you add it all up, and I'm not one of these who sometimes you see the reaction, oh, your man has left, he's useless.
Yeah.
I mean, Ben Teo has been a superb player for us. Even when things haven't gone great for us, he's played very well for us.
Mm-hmm.
It's taken him a while to get up to that level.
He has, but he's worked it.
He's now getting there.
Yeah, but you can see the work that he's worked at it. Like, he's not one of these guys who's come over and, you know, taking the checks and sat in his ass.
He's not a shirker.
You can see his work ethic. But when you consider that, I mean, they're talking about what? Nearly €600,000 is what Worcester are paying for him.
At least.
When you take that figure and you combine it with the fact that our replacement firm is, you know, one of the brightest prospects in Irish rugby, the maths adds up for Leinster.
Yeah. Unfortunately, we're also losing Ian Madigan, who plays 12 as well as 10. So, you know, there's a bit of a gaping hole developing there. So hopefully we can fill it from...
he gets a lot of stick.
From the academy.
He set up that try really well.
He did?
Like, he's super going forward with the ball in his hand.
He's awesome. Yeah.
But there's more to just one side. There's two sides of the ball.
There is, yeah.
You know what I mean? There's defence and there's attack. And then there's a lot of times, like, we saw it the previous week, he was kicking balls out on the full. You know what I mean? Like,
making bad choices.
Bad choices. Even in the Ireland game against France, you know, when we needed the ball.
He kicked out in the full,
You know, it's these sort of things that... There's just these little pimples on what could be a great...
Did he miss touch last weekend, or was...
That no, fairness, yeah, he did, but I wouldn't. I
from a penalty. But
no, that was Kircher.
Was Kircher, right?
The problem with Madigan today is the problem that was expressed about Madigan 3 years ago: is that can he control a game? Can he manage a game? And the answer is still not really. Kind of, perhaps.
Mm.
Yeah, but I think that the 2 years that O'Connor was here corrupted his career.
I agree,
because if he had, like as we said before, if Jackson has been given all the time in the world to develop, excellent. And someone like very, very few players are going to come in as a 19-year-old and say, right, I can actually, you know, play like a seasoned international with 50 caps. Most people go through a learning curve. Anytime he was getting to the top of his learning curve, he was dropped or, you know, and neither the two out-halves that were there went on to own that jersey. It was flip-flop between the two of them, and... You know, I think it hindered his career massively. And then, obviously, Sexton coming back in, it's curtains for him, really, to play 10.
Yeah. Well, we were hoping he'd play 12, but now with Robbie Henshaw coming in anyway, was he going to get any game time in either position? So he's probably did the right thing from his own point of view, and hopefully he can make a name for himself over there, because the guy has buckets of talent. Like, he really has. He's incredibly talented rugby player. If he finds his niche, finds his notch, and irons out the few wrinkles he has, he could be...
He's very unusual for really a player of his notch. Type. If you look at players of his type, down through history, as it were, your Stuart Barnes's, your Freddie Michalak's, your Carlos Spencer's, even Shane Geraghty, right? If they weren't playing well, their whole game went to pot, right? You look at Madigan, if he's not playing well, his goal kicking is still... rock solid, and if you notice, if you remember what we've watched occasions where, say, Freddie Michalak was playing and he wasn't playing well and his goal kicking collapsed. That never happens with Madigan.
No, I don't think he's that kind of a player. I think that's a bit of a misconception. I don't think he's such. I mean, obviously, all rugby players, especially tens, are confidence players to some degree. But like a Carlos Spencer, he was just a real, and Freddie too, I suppose, is a real. They're real mercurial talents. Danny Cipriani is probably another one. I don't think Madigan has liked it. I think he's got an abundance of confidence. Okay, it deserts him at times, but you know.
Sure, that's the problem with them as
but
well.
But that's the problem with nearly all players at 10, no matter how good they are. Even Dan Carter, well, maybe not Dan Carter, but everyone else you can see having, in fact, Carter too, you can see them having bad games and losing confidence. But I don't think that's necessarily his big issue. I just think. It's you know, I suppose if any of us could put our finger on it, we'd be he would have solved it years ago. But
I don't know. I mean, you look at your Dan Carters, your Ron O'Gara's, Stephen Jones, the other type of out half, if you like. Right? Mm-hmm. If things weren't going well for them, they just settled back and relied on their basics.
Yeah.
Right.
But isn't that what the All Blacks do anyway? Every one of them, they do the simple things well, and they just
he doesn't. That's my point.
That's it exactly. Yeah. Like he makes too many errors.
Yeah.
He could do some fantastic things, but he just his error level, like not his kicking now, but his errors around the pitch.
His kicking from the tee is
rock solid.
Absolutely exemplary.
You divorce that out of an overall game.
Kicking from hand, though.
It's kicking from hand. It's decision making. Mm-hmm. It's making a wrong decision. And you can only might have to make 100 decisions, but if you make that one wrong decision at the wrong time, it can be,
catastrophic.
Catastrophic, exactly. But one guy, obviously Levy got a great try,
mm-hmm.
but we just seem to have this conveyor belt of producing back rowers. I mean,
the talent level
that is there is ferocious.
Yeah, and there's guys coming through that are not going to get a chance because of what's ahead of them, guys who've developed who are going to get thrown on the scrappy barely because of what's behind them. It's a great problem to have.
In a way, we're kind of lucky that we've kept, obviously Van der Fleur is playing for Arnhem now and Levy is playing well for Leinster when he gets his opportunities. But the two guys who were the next guy on the rank before them were Gilson and Coughlin. And both of them have had to leave to get game time.
Yeah, yeah. And, the good thing about these guys leaving, hopefully their heart stays here and if they're needed and they develop really well.
Here's a question, right?
They may come back.
Since Leo and Shane Jennings went and came back, every time a player leaves, Lens fans go, "Oh, when he goes, he'll come back."
Yeah.
Right, with the exception of Fionn Carr and Jamie Hagan, who frankly, didn't add a whole lot when they did come back. Has anyone ever come back to any benefit?
Johnny Sexton,
yeah, that's the one.
He's the one.
But if you think of all the ones who've left, like your Shane Monaghan's, who's now left rugby, I believe he's gone into mixed martial arts.
Mm.
Niall Morris, all those guys. Everybody always says James Hart. Oh, but when they come back.
Many of those would you want back? How many of those were asked back? Mm. Like Niall Morris, I'm sure was asked. He's been playing well for Leicester. James Hart, I don't know. I know he's moving again, isn't he?
But how many of them are actually the best player in the league? Do you know what I mean?
That's what I'm saying.
Very few of them have gone and said, "God, we really let a gem go there," and all of a sudden they're
exactly.
Like, just say for instance, the guy that Munster left, the scrum half, sorry, the out half that
went. Hanrahan.
He looked to be a very good player, and I saw him playing in a couple of the European Cup. I don't really watch too much of the Aviva Premiership, but to come to the European Cup matches, he looked fantastic against when they played Racing Metro. He was just as good as Dan Carter that day, and. But there's very few of those players that leave and you go, Jesus, we kind of let a great talent slip through. It's just the fellas that aren't quite good enough to make it at Leinster. Because they're not good enough, they have to go elsewhere if they want to continue playing professionally.
Well, again, Johnny Sexton is the big exception to that one.
But very few.
He left for a set of reasons that we're all aware of. I mean, he didn't leave because he wasn't getting an opportunity because the guy's blocking him.
That's true.
I'm always of a belief that this whole thing, your man's not getting a game because somebody's blocking him. If he was good enough, he'd get his game. I mean, it's a professional sport. The best guy will play, otherwise the coach loses his job.
And at the end of the day, rugby in Ireland is a business.
Yeah, yeah.
It's an absolute business, and they are ruthless. And if you're not cutting it, you're gone. And it's not really a case of, I might go away and try.
If you don't cut it, you're cut.
You're cut, and you are gone. And you can end up going and playing with Rotherham or, whoever in English First Division.
Yeah, and getting fairly... not very well reimbursed for it,
Well, that's the thing. It just strikes me. We always say that when a guy leaves, maybe he'll get... if they leave, do we want them back? And, will they come back in the first place after being let go from their home province?
Well, I'm hoping Madigan is the exception to that rule. Mm. I'm hoping he really goes and makes a name for himself in the top 14 and then gets pissed off with the amount of games he has to play.
He's kind of in the same bracket as the Jennings... the Cullens, and insofar as there hasn't been too many guys that have got multiple Irish caps,
and left.
A fairly regular starter from any of the provinces going away.
Madigan's in a unique position in that there's very few guys, like you say, multiple Irish caps, considered by everyone to be a top level player, but just have a guy blocking them. Jennings had that. He had a guy blocking him in the Irish setup. Cullen had guys blocking him in the Irish setup.
Yeah.
And Madigan has guys blocking him. So he is in a relatively unique position. It doesn't come along all that often where a guy has all the ability to stay it out, but just can't because the guy the next level up is there. Funnily enough, I mentioned kind of, if you like, more some of the more for want of a better phrase, and it's not flakier out halves earlier. The thing is, Madigan will actually one of the things that Madigan has that will help him survive in France better than maybe some of those might is his physicality. He's a tough.
He's a half little bugger.
He's a tough little bucko, so he is.
He loves it though. Remember a couple of, I think it was maybe Sexton's first season in France. The amount of times he took the ball, tap and goes himself. I'd say he got two or three tries from 5 meters out. Most of us are going, take your points. And next of all, he grabs the ball and he scores.
He can get over from 5 yards. Something we kind of need.
And defensively, he's very strong as well. He's a hard tackler.
He can tackle,
Like, it was just one of the very positive. We were a bit down on him, but there was one thing that he did during the game. He threw out a pass that must have been 30 metres, 35 metres. And it really got the play. Then
took the eye out of a spider.
Are you sure that wasn't actually Ben Teo to Ben Teo?
It was his second pass.
All right, okay.
Madigan started it off. He threw 35 metres. Teo threw 30 metres as well. And it just created so much space on the far side. It was like a quarterback's throw across the pitch.
Mm-hmm.
And I think we made about 60 metres in the play.
The problem with Madigan is he has a massively powerful pass. The problem is it's quite unsympathetic. If it
goes to anyone numbered 1 to 8,
I was about to say, if it goes to a forward,
it can be fairly unsympathetic, and it's cost him in the past.
Yeah.
But you know, he's going to be a guy that's. There are very few teams in Europe could sit a guy like Ian Madigan on the bench, and it's been a luxury we've had this year. It's a luxury we're going to lose now, and the question is. For us, is Cathal Marsh the next guy, or do we need someone in?
That is going to be a very big, question next year, isn't it?
Yeah.
And we saw, a few years ago now, he got injured. But we've got Dan Carter's backup.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
From the Crusaders.
Yeah.
And now he got injured. He broke his leg, I think, in the second match of the season.
Against Ospreys.
So he didn't get a chance. But it's somebody like that that's prepared to sit on the bench. You know, now, Cathal Marsh, I'm sure, was very prepared to sit on that because he's a young man starting out his career.
Mm-hmm.
But as you saw, many games Madigan has played this year, because Sexton's going to be away with Ireland for large chunks of the season.
If Sexton plays 15 games outside of the playoffs next year, that's the height of it.
Sexton will play half the games next year, and another will play the other.
We're going to need a guy, and
you have to. You kind of have to back Marsh, but you still need a Sean Byrne type character on
also,
the bench,
don't forget,
or within the organisation somewhere.
Don't forget, you've also got Robbie Henshaw, so he's going to be disappearing as well. So you need
definitely Sean Byrne type character.
What's his name, Tom?
Tom Daly.
Daly come through at 12 and fill void.
He's certainly got the physical attributes.
He's as big as Robbie Henshaw.
Any time we've seen him play for Leinster A, he's looked good. If he's finished wasting his time with sevens.
And you might see Ringrose getting called up next season as well.
You could
see the guys that are currently filling in the gaps while the internationals are away at the moment.
Mm-hmm.
Like even Josh Van de Flyer is... Mm-hmm. Would have been someone who you might have said, he's going to get plenty of game time while Heaslip and O'Brien are away with
injured.
The national team. Or injured. or Geordie Murphy. Do you know what I mean? You're taking away three. Or Ruddock. There's four back rowers that are going to be on international duty. So there was opportunities for younger lads to come through. But now there's five international back rowers.
The problem is when they take those opportunities.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely.
Actually, there's a guy who played out top quite well, actually, Geordie Murphy.
He seems to be coming to a bit of form.
His form dropped off there for a while, but
I heard him interviewed there a couple of weeks ago, and since the World Cup he's been injured quite a lot, which I didn't know. So no wonder he's been in iffy form. He hasn't been in the whole of his health, so Stanster, and here we were thinking it was this, it was that, it was was he.
If only those updates from Leinster Rugby
were accurate. But it's funny because you hear a player interviewed and he said, I've been injured and I've had this and I've had that.
I heard, I think it was Ringrose actually, was saying they were doing exams.
That's right.
I think that's the reason why
he's not. That's why he didn't start in Europe in November, because he was doing his exams, So, do fans in general need to know all that stuff? I know obsessive types like us might want to know them, but, is it necessary, really, that we're told all these little things?
It depends on your definition of the word need.
Well, we don't need, obviously.
Yeah.
The hierarchy of needs. We
obsessively want. Whether we actually need is another thing, but that's the nature of sport. No, Leinster did. I always think when you beat Ospreys, it's something to be. You can be pleased with yourself, and now we've done the double over them. I mean, wins against the Ospreys have been few and far between in the recent history. I mean, talking about the last 5 years of Leinster rugby.
This was a really callow Ospreys team.
It was.
I know, but considering what, like, just say if you compare back to the team that played, say, in the grand final a couple of years ago against us, you know what I mean? There's chalk and cheese in that team, and like, great that we got the win. 4 points, always very beneficial this time of the year.
Mm-hmm.
But like, let's put it into perspective. We did play one of the weakest Ospreys selections that we've ever had to play.
I'm not going to be preparing a place for my replica Pro 12 trophy based on that result. But what I am going to do is I'm going to say, yeah, okay, it's a result delivered against a team that we don't often get result against, and it brings us to what now, 18 out of 20 in this period of games.
Yep.
Which is bang on target for what we want. You know, where we want to be.
If only we hadn't lost to the Dragons in the rain back in January. But anyway, I figure we need to win out of our games against. I'm taking that we're going to beat Treviso, and I'm taking that we're going to beat Edinburgh at home, which I probably shouldn't take. But out of the other four games, three of them are away. Ulster, Connacht and Glasgow. We're going to have to win two of those games. So we're going to have to.
We've got very, like you mentioned. The six games. Two of them are kind of gimme. Well, one is a gimme.
Yeah.
Then you've got Ulster.
Ah, come on. Munster are a bit tougher than that.
You've got Ulster away. That's going to be
tough.
You've got Connacht away, which will come.
Very tough.
Very tough at the moment.
Glasgow away.
Very hard. Especially, we're going to be playing on a quagmire pitch.
And Munster at home.
Like, it doesn't matter if Munster could be last in the league and, you know,
they still want to beat us.
If they're going to go for one game in the year, they're going to go for this one.
It will be the game when we get all our Ireland players back, though. I would think.
Both of them.
Well,
they've got five or six now at the moment. Got Dunica Ryan, Simon Zeebo, they've got CJ Stander, Connor Murray.
Okay, three of them.
Keith Earls. That's four. Five.
We've got, 18 away?
I'm just talking about the people starting.
Slight difference.
We probably don't have too many more than that starting.
No, it'll be a tough game. Munster and Leinster games always exist within their own sphere of existence, of reality, divorced from everything else.
I wouldn't like to be going into the Munster game on the two defeats on the bounce to Glasgow and Connacht. You know?
No, I said it before. It could be the most fortunate piece of scheduling ever is our last game.
Yeah.
No, because you get the sense if we needed 5 points. I mean, I said it last week. I've been jocular about, you know, been hostage to fortune. But at least we know going into that match that, you know, getting a big points haul is an option.
If we go into the match against Treviso in second place by a point, we're in a home semi final. You know, but it's getting from here to there is the problem.
Yeah.
Because if we lose to Glasgow and Connacht, we need to beat Ulster. And Munster. We need to win in Ravenhill and we need to beat Munster. You need to win all our games if we lose the next two, you know.
So we're win all our games anyway.
We're on 57 points, which is two behind.
Yeah.
Like, we dropped actually a point to Connacht.
Yeah.
And they had a great win against Edinburgh on Friday night. But they should have won that game by
a lot more,
30
yeah.
points.
Yeah.
But they somehow or other seemed to just take the foot off the gas and let Edinburgh back into it. And then Edinburgh decided, if we run at their left wing, we might have a chance here.
Yeah.
And like,
somebody should have sent them a copy of the Clonetley match, or what Clonetley did to Ulster on Craig Gilroy. Mm. Because you pick out the weak link and you go for it remorselessly. The problem with Connacht is they are poor defensively. Now, to a certain extent, some of that is down to concentration. Like you said, they dropped off that game for 10 minutes, and been concentrated and focused for 80 minutes is a function of defence.
But by Jesus, can they attack?
Yeah, but that's only half the game, John. I mean,
it is half the game, but it's the exciting half.
Well, yeah, you can lose games doing it. Do you remember the history of Leinster Rugby 2002 to 2009?
I do.
Do you remember how great we used to play? Do you remember all those trophies? Oh, no, there weren't any.
Yeah.
Like,
I hear you.
our defence compared to theirs, we have conceded just 16 tries.
Mm.
They've conceded 38.
But they've scored how many?
They've only scored 11 more than us. Like they've conceded 22 tries more than us. And we've scored 11 less than them. So, they're thereabouts. But the thing that's keeping them on top is their bonus points.
Mm-hmm.
They've had 7 winning bonus points and 4 losing bonus points.
Right? Yeah.
Sorry, 7, 4 try bonus points.
Yeah.
And that's what's pushing them a little bit.
Well, like you said, plus 11, that's 2 try, that's 10 tries, that's 2 try bonus points, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So
it's where, it's a bit like voting, it's where you get them as well, you know. No good getting 16 in one game and then none in the next 3, you know. However, I'm
but that, I mean, how many times have we seen
they're also
good,
in the good
Leinster
Cup
teams going over well, to Edinburgh forget. And getting turned over, and that you know, the Elephant's graveyard in front of 3,000 people in a 70,000 seater stadium, you know,
rattling
around, and you know, if it starts to rain and it just becomes a desolate place, and you know, but fair play to because they were, it could easily slip away, you know, and
when that game turned against them, they could have let it, they could have let the turn complete itself,
exactly,
but they didn't.
Yeah, they didn't. I mean,
and that's to their credit.
Like, they made some good substitutions, you know, they brought on guys that were, you know, they took advantage of, but more to the point that they were able to target guys that were clearly tiring,
mm-hmm.
brought on fresh legs that, you know, that, like, that's one thing that Pat Lam has done. He's actually strengthened the squad very well.
Yeah.
And they had loads of injuries during the year.
And he's upskilled them like you wouldn't believe. Like,
yeah, but, you know, and like, even the guy, your man scoring the try there, like, you know, many times we had a scrum 5 yards out from the line and couldn't convert it.
Well, I was about to say that both and Ireland internationally and Wales internationally, getting over that last 5 yards is, you know, Connacht can do it damn easily. They just have it down like the way Leinster used to have 3 seasons ago, where if they got the ball in attack, you'd know it was a matter of time they were going over that line. Connacht, they're a bit like that. Leinster, unfortunately, aren't. So, you know, we'll have to see how that one develops. But I'm really enjoying watching Connacht. I think they've upskilled massively. They're a joy to watch. Yes, they're a little bit naive defensively, but, you know, that'll come. And I'm really hoping they're going to make a home semi-final and seeing the sports ground packed for the visit of whoever.
Yeah, well, all the Irish teams won at the weekend. Munster got a good win against the Dragons.
Mm.
Don't think, I just from what I read, I didn't see it, that they...
I fast-forwarded through a lot of it, but they got in over...
It's kind of the best way to watch the Dragons.
They got in over the line for the bonus point at the last, at 78 minutes or something, you know, which is, you know, it's good to get there, you know, it's good to... It wasn't a scintillating game, but they did what they had to do, you know. I think the fact that Edinburgh and Scarlets both lost really opened the door for, or Edinburgh and Ospreys, I mean, both lost, really opened the door for Munster to get a bit more solid in the European place, and also possibly get into the playoffs as well. It's not beyond the bounds. They're kind of scrapping really with Scarlets, Ulster, and Glasgow. In my book,
they have a game in hand. If they win their game in hand match.
Yeah,
they actually go into joint third place with Scarlets.
That's not a gimme though. Cardiff away. Munster's problem anymore. All
season hasn't been that door. They've been able to wedge that door open. The problem all season has been keeping it open because they haven't been able to put through a coherent set of results. They win 2, they lose 2, they win 1, they lose another 1, they win 3, they lose 2. You know, that kind of way. They haven't been able to keep the momentum going. They've been unfortunate. Because one thing, more than any other team in Ireland, the Irish team has actually stripped them of really, really key players.
They're their only class players. Yeah.
Whereas if you looked at our team,
if you took out the internationals and you took out the guys that were sitting watching us who were injured, there's still, like, if you look at and you go through the team that played on Saturday, there's still probably, I don't know, 6, 7, or 8 internationals playing in that team. There's guys like Ringrose is going to be earmarked for an international. You Springbok, you had Ben Teo who could play for England. Do you know what I mean? You've got really, really good players.
Who could play for Fiji?
But you've got really, really good players within that team. If you look at there's very few fellas that you're looking at the Munster kind of going, yeah, he's going to be a super player in 2 years' time. There's very few.
Mm. They have a couple, but not very many. Mm. I think that Scannell is going to be a very good player.
Mm-hmm. I like Jack O'Donoghue.
Yeah.
Joe Schmidt seems to like him too. Got him into the
zone. You were out watching him train today, John?
I was. They were doing a lot of work on defence, guys.
the only problem for him is that he's one of a plethora of guys all around the same age, all around the same build, all of whom pretty much played the same way. Mm. It's kind of like the Irish cookie cutter back row forward at this stage.
Yeah, isn't it?
Yeah.
If we played rugby league instead of rugby, you'd be laughing.
Oh yeah.
You just got this build of player that would be ideal.
Yeah, I think he's about 6'3" or 6'4" and he's kind of Geordie Murphy shaped.
Yeah.
A little bit longer.
A whole load of guys. You got all those guys. You've got Conan. You've got a whole bunch of them. the thing from Munster is, you know, they are more affected than probably even Ulster by call-ups, because Ulster have that plethora of midfield backs that to fall back on. Munster don't really have that. When they lose Conor Murray, their choices are Tomás O'Leary, who's not what he once was, and Duncan Williams, who never really has been.
He's improved though from a very, very low
base. They lose CJ Stander. Most of their play is based around CJ Stander.
Mm.
So then of course their strike runners are Zeebo and Earls. They lose those guys. Which is why they haven't been able to take it back to the original point. Why they haven't been able to put together a coherent set of results.
You're saying they don't have many players in the area. So you've just named five or six.
They
actually have more than they have had. You know, they're creeping back. Maybe that's some of those injuries. Like Dutch Elm disease. Maybe some of that is injuries, but they're still putting a fair few players compared to where they were a year ago into the Irish team, you know.
And it's no wonder we've lost championship.
Never give it a break, do you? Never give it a rest.
No.
Well, the other Irish team, Ulster.
You never take your foot off a man's throat and it's down, John.
The other Irish team, Ulster, they scraped through with a bonus point against Zebre as well on Friday night, like literally the last play.
That was another fast forward game.
And how Marshall held on to the ball, as I think Stephen Ferris said after the match, he says, "I've trained with him for nearly 10 years and I've never seen him catch a ball like that."
Yeah, well, speaking of fellas catching balls or dropping balls, Glasgow would have had a try bonus point if a certain Mark Bennett hadn't have dropped the ball over the line in dreadful fashion. Like, it was, you know, it was one of those.
It's probably the most embarrassing thing you can do.
It really is, and it was quite an embarrassing one, and he nearly got away with it. Only they went up and had a look at it.
I can imagine.
Damn technology!
I can imagine on a video session in Carlton House on Monday morning, Robbie Henshaw queuing it up, going, "See, I'm not so bad. I'm not so bad."
But yeah, that's probably a big loss for Glasgow and missing that bonus point. You know, if they miss out on a playoff place or miss out on a home play or whatever it is by a point,
but like,
he's going to get a kick in
both
the hole.
Glasgow and Edinburgh are both on the same points, so there's a bit of a scrap going on. Even if they, you know what I mean, if
two games in hand.
Yeah, but
three Italians to play.
One is against us, though. One of those.
Yeah, but they've three games against opposition.
You expect them to beat the Italians, but they're not playing well. Glasgow are not the team they were last year.
No, they've lost a lot of players, and they
difficult second syndrome. Difficult second album syndrome seems to have settled in there.
Well, always when you're the champions, you've got a target on your forehead. And
but there's also, like what's happened in Munster, they mightn't have as much strength and depth. Like, they lost a few guys during the summer, probably didn't replace the same quality. When you strip out, you know, the more successful they are, the more that's going to be involved with the Scottish team, and therefore the guys that are coming in as replacements have to step up, and they clearly haven't.
Yeah, well, hopefully if they're missing at least 18 to 20 players when we go over to visit them next week, because, you know, we could do with them being missing a few as soon as they're at home. And the drier the tracks get coming to the end of the season, the more it's going to suit Glasgow. I mean, they still have your man, the big lad, your mate Jason, what's his name again?
Oh, I can't remember now.
Tequili Nairavuro, that's him.
That's the fella.
So
and there's the other big lad that Jason's going to tell us his name.
Oh, Jerry Yanni Yannatawa.
Yanni Yannatawa.
That's the man, yeah. They're your two best mates, I've heard. You like to go drinking with them. And after about 8 pints, you like to say their names repeatedly to them.
Just call them Tom and Jerry.
So, yeah, actually, that's a good name.
Not bad, actually.
But yeah, the guys like that are probably going to earn their coin in games.
They signed Sarto for next season.
That's right, I saw that today. Yeah, yep. They just signed your man Sarto. So he's a good kind of DTH van der Merwe replacement.
Yeah,
he could score a few tries for them, I'd say. But he's not really a Takili Naira Voro replacement.
He's a finisher. He's not going to one man wrecking ball.
No, very few people are.
Yeah, I mean, to a certain extent, it's not necessarily a bad thing that, you know, that the title changes, or that the challenger for the title changes on a regular basis.
Mm-hmm.
For the league, I mean,
it's good for the league. Yeah.
Ospreys and ourselves kind of had our period of time. Hopefully ours is coming back again. Connacht seemed to be up the top. Glasgow had 2 or 3 years at it. Ulster kind of got close without ever sealing the deal, and there seems to be a constant turnover, which is not bad. It indicates either quality or a lack thereof.
Well, like the Highlanders in the Southern Hemisphere are the Connacht of New Zealand. So, and they won the title last year in Super Rugby. So that'd be like Connacht winning the European Cup. Like they won that last year without an international forward in their team anywhere. I mean, that's incredible. So if Connacht could do something, if they could win the Pro 12 even, never mind Europe. If I was a Connacht fan, I'd be looking for the Pro 12 and Challenge Cup double. There'll be a few English heavyweights in that. Don't forget there's a place up for grabs. Actually, I heard Gerry Darnley on the other day saying about that we have six teams. Did he retract that?
He wrote a piece about based on roughly the same thing this morning and was published. I don't know if it was published in the paper, but it was published online and it had to be pulled and it was rewritten and it took him about 3 hours to rewrite before it was republished at about 11.
Gerry Thornley is a really professional guy generally, and he's not a guy who rests on his laurels. He takes an interest and he works hard. And
it just
shows
how confusing this whole constantly changing vista in front of us is if it catches out somebody like Gerry Thornley.
Well, there you go, but... Yeah, he seemed to think that you couldn't get all four provinces in because only six teams qualified and you had to have one of each nation, whereas actually seven do. And he also thought there was a playoff, which there isn't. It's the winner of the Challenge Cup gets into Europe next year, no matter what country they're from. So they take the last place in Europe 1, shall we call it now? That's my new name for it, Europe 1. Europe 1 and Europe 2, rather than, because they're both the ECC. They're both, you know...
The Champions Cup and the UEFA Cup.
Whatever. But so, we could, of course, have four provinces. We have to have... It gets funny if a Scottish team don't get into the top six. That's where it gets funny, because then if it's all Irish and Welsh in the top six, then number six is not going in. That's where it gets funny. It doesn't get funny with four Irish teams, though. So four Irish and one of each of the rest is quite possible, and here's to it.
Well, we turn our attention to the internationals that are at the weekend. We play Italy. Rob Carney sat out training today.
He did.
Tweaked hammer.
Noticeable by his absence. He wandered out towards the end of the session and sat beside the pitch. The team lined up with Zeebo at fullback and Payne in the centres. So... Everybody who wants Henshaw at 13 and Stuart McCluskey at 12 will be disappointed by the looks of training today.
Smith
anyway.
Sang Payne's praises after all the matches, but particularly the match against France. You know, sort of his defence, considering he was on one leg and he needed to come off at half time and he didn't. He plays out, blah blah blah, and he also was a little bit. Not very complimentary towards McCluskey.
No, he was less than effusive.
Yeah.
He didn't say anything bad about him.
No, he didn't. But it was just, he didn't.
To a certain extent, he damned him with faint praise.
Well, I think that the reason that he likes Payne in there is he's an experienced guy. He's not going to be playing for Ireland forever. I mean, he's now 30? 30-ish. So he's... He's an experienced guy in the centre of the pitch in position that we've had two guys for 15 years with very few exceptions, the odd injury. So there's been it's been the one area of the team that's been settled, and it's the one area of the team that wasn't settled in the past kind of 18 months or so. In this competition, we've been dogged with injuries all over the place. We're having to put combinations together that are unfamiliar. So I think that Schmidt wants to keep as much of a familiar, like if he's got 10, 12, 13 of Payne, Henshaw and Sexton.
Do you think that Payne is there to help guide Henshaw?
In many ways, possibly, yeah.
I think he's there to be the pivot to guide a lot of guys. He's the pivot around which the Irish...
Defensively, especially.
In particular, defensively, around which that Irish defensive line rests.
Because Henshaw's new enough to that position too.
Yes.
People forget, I mean, to a certain extent, Payne wasn't brought over to Ireland to play fullback. He was brought over to Ireland to replace Brian O'Driscoll. That's why he was brought into the Irish system. That's why he was brought over as a project player. He wasn't brought over to play fullback, so I don't know why people are surprised when he's played at outside centre.
Well, because a lot of people, and many of them Ulster fans, think that he's better at 15 and 12 coming into the line rather than being in it. But, you know, that's my take on it.
Before his injury, he used to glide over the ground at 15, and some of his
counter-attacking
into the line was just sensational. Now, it's
still bloody good.
It is still good. We haven't seen enough of it. And you're going to see less of it from 12 than you would see it from 15.
Yeah. 13, I suppose, is where he's playing. But
guys, coaches always have guys that they like. In it doesn't matter what coach you're talking about: American football, basketball, soccer, rugby. I think Payne at 13 is Joe's avatar, his on-field avatar to a certain extent. He runs the team from that position. Not in the captaincy sense, but just in a purely organisational sense.
And he's a fellow North Islander. You can trust him.
I heard an interview with O'Driscoll, and I heard it. He said it again recently, but he said it maybe just shortly after he retired, and then he said it in another interview. And both times he said that they had to, when Schmidt took over at Leinster, they had to gain the trust of Schmidt because he wanted to play a very conservative game. And when it took them quite some time to try and convince him that they were good enough to play an expansive game. And he said it, he reiterated it again, and maybe this team just isn't good enough or doesn't have the characters in it.
Well, in fairness, didn't Joe Schmidt say very early on, before he joined Leinster, that he wanted to make him the best passing team in Europe?
But you can pass it along four passes and then kick it.
Yeah, but you know, I don't think that's where he was going when he said that. You know, I think that most people who realise what Brian O'Driscoll can do, especially with the offloads and the little giddly passes and all that, were bound to use him in both in Ireland. And
that's my point, that we don't have the players, and therefore that's why we play a limited game.
Of course, absolutely, and especially the transition once he retired. You know, we were bound to limit ourselves because we just didn't have that fluency in the
core. But it was great when we were watching the team win.
Of course.
But now that we have, and like there's more and more little daggers are starting to come out, you know.
Yeah.
Like I noticed there was an article today from Gavin Comiskey, very critical. Like the headline was actually made the article seem extremely violent towards the team, but as when you read it, it didn't seem to make
it. I didn't see it, no.
Yeah, but like there's just these daggers are starting to come out, and you know, but this team needs to win. We need to win this match against Italy.
Oh, yeah.
You know, for the confidence of the team and as I said, to get the people off their back.
Well, for world ranking points, they need to win them. These are the two most important games we play in this calendar year now. We can't really gain any world ranking points.
You don't gain points against teams below you, right?
You do, yeah.
No,
it's teams within 10 points of you.
They can gain points on us, sorry, that's what I mean. They can gain points on us.
If you lose to a team...
are less than 13.
If we lose to Italy, we lose points.
Yeah.
If we lose to Scotland, we lose points.
But like, come on.
If we beat Italy, we don't gain very many.
No. If we lose to South Africa, we don't lose very many. We lose to New Zealand. who's the minnow in...
Canada.
These games are very important because obviously... You need your position in the world rankings, and also, you know, apparently the Six Nations is worth €500,000 per position.
Really?
They actually said a million. Don Lennon said a million.
Is it a million? It's a considerable amount of cash. You know, I mean, that is good players for a couple of provinces. That is pitches for juniors. That is all sorts of things. And that's a lot of money.
That's money from the RBS. No doubt, there's money from Three and Canterbury and whoever else are their sponsors for. You know,
maybe that's the roll up is a million, and because I always
Lennon said it off the ball or against the head. Also.
So that's a lot of money. I mean, it's we can potentially finish third, I believe, if we win both against...
I haven't even crunched the numbers on
it. If we win against Italy and Scotland... Now, this is what I'm led to believe. I'm not sure of the numbers. If we win against Italy and Scotland and other results go our way, we can finish third. Which would...
I don't see why not. Well, if Scotland lose to France... Or sorry, if France lose to Scotland and we beat Scotland, that's a big advantage. Because Wales and England are going to come first and second. So that's how we get third if Scotland have to beat France, I think.
Yeah. And England play France in the last day.
Yeah, Wales and England, though, that's going to be a cracker. It's going to be the game of the weekend, I would think. Everything at stake. Winner takes all.
But going back, lose.
Going back to our game, though, like, we've still got problems in our defence. Like, you know, we haven't been hockeyed, except like under Joe Schmidt's regime, say, for the last 2 years. We haven't been hockeyed. The only match that we kind of were was against Argentina. But we still, like, England ran at us a couple of times. A bit similar to sort of the Connacht match.
Yeah.
They just, and they made huge inroads into our.
But maybe it comes back to what we were talking about again. Who's the defensive leader in the Irish system at the moment? It's always, or for the last, you know, 12 to 18 months, it's been Jarrod Payne.
Yeah.
And he wasn't there for that game. Now he's back. Will that make it? I mean, obviously, against Italy won't be the sternest test, although they're not bad at 10, 12, 13. And obviously, you've got Parise coming through the middle.
I thought he was shite, Dave.
Well, he can. It depends on whether
he's. But you expect them to put up a very strong performance for the first 50 minutes, and then, like, going traditionally, they kind of fade then with 30 to go. And that's where we won the championship 2 years ago, because we. If you remember, we brought on a load of subs, and all the subs scored,
And it was Dricko's farewell home game.
Yeah, yeah. But when they were kind of fading. And
it's a game, what everyone thinks of Parise, it's a game where he's traditionally always played quite poorly. He doesn't play well in the Aviva Stadium. It's just as simple as that. He doesn't.
Good.
So
we take every advantage we can get, thanks.
So they're good at 10, 12, 13, but they're not that good that they should cause us any major problems. Yeah. If we're on our game. And the thing is, the Irish team, it's funny, it was an accusation that was made last year of Leinster about how unskilled Leinster looked. Ireland looked pretty unskilled. You know, they seem to have problems transferring, like, just talking about when Joe Schmidt said he was going to make Leinster the best passing team in the world, or the best passing team in Europe. Ireland do not look like one of the best passing teams in Europe. They don't even look like one of the best passing teams in Ireland.
No.
But, like, a lot of teams are looking like that. They have to, you know, it's the first thing that you learn when you're in school. You just pass the ball up and down the line, that you kind of, the ball's in front of you, that you run onto it, rather than the ball being flung at you, where you have to check your stride.
It's jump coming up, at your ear or jump behind up you.
To catch it exactly around your ears or down around your toes.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you know what I mean? Right in front of you. And it's the basic skill that people are taught when they first play minis rugby.
You know, maybe it was pressure England were putting on us, but I thought against England, we looked very unskilled.
There was one in that match against England. It was in our 22. There was very little pressure on us. The ball was thrown out. Each pass, there was three passes out in the 22, in our 22, where we had one guy actually had to stop and nearly pirouette around because he was that. He had to check his stride so much.
And it robbed so much of the momentum of the move.
I mean, these games are decided in, you know, millimeters and fractions of seconds. And if you've got to change your stride,
forget it.
You're not going to beat the man anymore.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's a bit of a worrying note. Luckily, we're playing Italy next week.
Again, it gives us a chance.
Build a bit of confidence, and you know, because if we don't win these two last games, we're really looking.
The interesting question is, the Irish scrum has actually been under pressure. Irish scrums, not just the Irish scrum, but Irish scrums have been under pressure the last couple of.
Yeah.
We'd say the last month or so, both at international and provincial level, which is odd because we have good scrummagers.
It's funny, I was watching the Connacht match. Their scrum was actually doing well.
Mm.
And they had Nathan White, who was under pressure at international level and Pro 12 level are two different kettle of fish. But, like, still in all, it doesn't, like, when Mike Ross went off against England, the scrum disintegrated.
Mm-hmm.
Now, it wasn't an attacking force when he was on. But it was very solid.
Yeah.
Jeez,
when he went off, you know? And, like, it just brings me back to that match against Bath, over in Bath in October.
Which we lost on a penalty try.
You know?
Right in front of us.
Like, it just goes to show, you mentioned last week, how important the tight head position is.
Mm.
Like, that was the ruination of our European season, pretty much, that loss in Ballot.
Oh, sorry, just to interject, I owe an apology to Harry Connick Jr. from last week. I meant to say Mickey Bubble, of course.
Okay, okay.
Harry Connick Jr. is, of course, a god and an amazing piano player and total legend who was...
Mickey Bubbles is a twat.
Who was taught by Wynton Marsalis's da, how to play piano when he was a kid. He's from New Orleans.
Wynton and Branford, don't forget Branford.
And Branford's dad. So, you know, sorry, Harry Connick Jr. I know it's nothing to do with rugby, but when I listened back to it, I went...
By Mr. Marsalis Sr., was it you?
Ellis Marsalis, yeah. Did I say that out loud? I said to myself. And I meant Mickey Bubble is Magnolia.
Yeah,
not Harry Connick Jr.
Well, I did take umbrage with your Harry Connick.
I
fully accept your Mickey Bubble proposition.
I can't believe I said it out loud. Anyway, back to the rugby. Thank you for this platform to put my apology to Mr. Connick Jr., who will never ever hear of this, thankfully. Go ahead, Jason.
Okay, thank you.
But but there is a big difference between scrummaging against England, and I don't know who Edinburgh had. I can't remember for the life of me who Edinburgh had out.
Was it Dell? Alan Dell?
Was it?
A tight head. Again, I may or may not have been awake at that point.
Jacobson, was he?
Oh, he's long gone. What would they call him? Chunk.
Mm-hmm. But, I mean, there is a big difference between Edinburgh and England. England. Do you remember that? The worst English scrum ever. It was good, wasn't it?
Yeah.
You know, that kind of a way.
Yeah.
So... But it is important. I mean, Italy don't seem to be the scrummaging power that they once were. I mean, they got pushed all over the gaff.
No.
Well, not last week, but the week before.
Mm. So did we.
Yeah. Well,
sadly.
Yeah, but you wouldn't expect that from Italy. I mean, a lot of the Italian game for a long time has been built based around their scrum, and it seems to... I mean,
Castro Giovanni is mangled, yeah.
Castro's out anyway,
but he's not the guy he was.
No, how old is he? Must be in his mid-30s now, right?
Yeah, he must be.
35, I think.
I mean, he's been a fantastic... He's been one of the best props, certainly in my lifetime, but...
No longer.
I mean, age comes to us all. It did to me, mm-hmm. and you. And
I'm still waiting for it.
Just what you mentioned there about props. What did you think of Keane Healy's performance last weekend?
It was a bit meh. It was a bit mixed, I think.
I thought he was trying a bit too hard.
I thought he showed willing.
Yes.
But he was getting stuck in, all right.
And I felt sorry for him. Like, we know how good he is.
Mm-hmm.
And he just wants to be back to where he was. And he got a very easy pass, and he
fumbled him,
and I felt really sorry for him.
There's a narrative out there that Keane Healy is finished, you know?
Yeah, well, that's horseshit.
And it's ridiculous. I mean, Keane Healy is, for probably the third or fourth time this year, or the last 12 to 18 months...
Fighting his way back from injury.
Mm. And every player goes through a period of time where they get a lot of injuries, generally around the age that Keane Healy is right now, actually, and then they kind of push on.
Hopefully.
So, I mean, there's not that unusual for a guy his age... to be, you know, trying to come back from injuries or a couple of injuries one after the other. He's very unlucky that they're kind of one on top of the other.
But
I guarantee you, by the time he runs out against South Africa, and he will, he'll be back. I'd say he's got over that phase. He'll be back to his best.
He's played a huge amount of first grade rugby.
That was his 150th appearance for Leinster.
Yeah, and you probably had another 50 Irish caps into that.
Easy, yeah.
You know, like, that's 200 first-class games at Loosehead Park.
For a guy who's quite young still, you know.
Like, that's an awful lot of... You know, it's different if you're, say, playing scrum half, playing 200 games, or second centre, than...
In prop terms, he's a young, very young man. Like, you know, when you look at Mike Ross...
Ross, he played... He had a good club career, you know, and he probably started off late. He didn't really do much in Munster.
2010 before he was captain for Ireland.
And then, like, he went over to Harlequins. But when he came back to Ireland, that his Irish career kind of took off. Now he's been, you know, pretty much
a fixture
for the last six or seven seasons. But as you say, it was only 2010 that he got...
When you consider how abrasive, as well, Keane plays, the style he plays is extraordinarily abrasive.
Like
he was very lucky to go so long without serious injury,
like,
as he went.
If you just say compare, I know it's different positions, but both props. If you compare, say, Mike Ross to Keane Healy, do you know what I mean? Like, Keane Healy also is in the scrum all the time, compared to, like, Mike Ross is. But the amount of work that he does around the pitch, ball in hand, cleaning out rooks, because he's first or second into the ruck, because he's just so fit,
mm-hmm.
you know, whereas someone like Mike Ross can just kind of
trundle
along to the next breakdown, get there, and it's
gone. And he knows that if somebody passes the ball to him, time will stand still, so he'll be able to move.
He scored against Harlequins, remember that?
Yeah, he did, that's right, yeah. No, I mean, Keane has been a huge success, servant to Leinster and Irish rugby, and will be again in the future. I have no doubt that he played 250 first-class games.
Here's to it. I'll drink to that.
Yeah. So anyway, just briefly before we go, we'll just look at the other two Six mm-hmm. Nations matches. So
mm-hmm.
England take on Wales, a repeat of the famous match from the Rugby World Cup.
They seem to have a lot of famous matches, England and Wales. They do tend to clash in important games quite a lot. I'm hoping for a draw.
The draw would be tasty, all right. Yeah, anything to deny a Grand Slam to the only remaining team that can get a Grand Slam would be good. I think Eddie Jones, I think I might have said this last week, but I think he'd be happy enough to just win a championship. Because if he wins a Grand Slam in his first season, where does he go from there? Nowhere. Another he can. He's got to get another
Back
Grand
to
Slam every week
Countless
or every
cash.
Year. But it's set up to be a belter. Like Gatland is the longest coach in the Northern Hemisphere, as far as I know, international coach, and he has a very settled team. Most of them are fit.
In an immensely surprised move, he's made no changes whatsoever to his team.
Exactly. Most of them are fit and they're ready to go. So they don't need much other than, you know, and they've got a few games under their belt. They drew with us, but, you know, they've won since then. And they've got a very handy one out in Italy in the last game. So
they're
looking good.
Fit.
However, England are also looking pretty good. And now they haven't been tested, you could argue. We're not as much of a test as we would have been in the past few years. And they've only played Scotland and Italy other than that. So this is a really big test for them, but I think Eddie Jones has put a bit of icing on top of the cake. That, like Stuart Lancaster, I think we all said it last year, he'd done a lot for the team, but he took them to a point and he ran out of ideas, and not even Andy Farrell in there could, and whoever else could come up with anything else to motivate the players or to get them over the line in the World Cup. They were kind of found out and they made a few bad decisions, but there wasn't, you've said it before, Dave, they were never that far away, even under Lancaster. They have the players, they have the depth, they have systems. A pretty good system going there, so I think they could be, and they've two Laggy back as well, crucially. I think they could be a big handful, and they're at home in Twickenham, so I kind of fancy England.
The other side of it is,
well, I hope Wales win. If anybody,
if you've ever seen Wales play in the last 10 years, you know exactly how Wales are going to play at the weekend.
Oh yeah.
The problem is stopping it, because they're really, really good at it.
Yeah.
He has a game plan that works for the players he wants to pick. He picks the players he wants to pick to play the game he wants to play, and they're really good at it. Everyone knows what they're going to do. It's
stopping them.
It's Gatland ball all the way. Problem is stopping it.
I said it earlier, like, they have been very fortunate, both teams actually, probably with injuries. Like, they're much their starting 15 are you know, are fit and available.
Mm-hmm.
And you compare, say, to Ireland, you know, obviously the English can dip in, they have a much deeper pool of talent than we do. But if you look at, like, say, going through our team of our starters, Mike Ross was injured.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, say, Sean O'Brien got injured against France. Johnny Sexton's come off injured. Payne has been injured.
Mm-hmm.
Rob Kearney has been injured.
Dave
Kearney. Keane Healy. So you're talking maybe...
Paul O'Connor retired. Peter O'Mahony's injured.
Exactly. So you're talking maybe sort of somewhere between 7 and 8 or 7 and 9 starters.
Mm-hmm.
If every single player available to Schmidt was fit... At some stage during this campaign, quite a large chunk of them have been injured.
That's why I would be wary about being hypercritical about. I said it last week against when we were discussing the England match. I'd be worried about being hypercritical about Schmidt's Ireland team against England because we were missing so many. But as you were saying, England and Wales have had a consistency of selection that I'd say Joe Schmidt could only dream about.
Yeah, but I mean, so the successful teams, even going back to the Leinster successful teams. We didn't really get affected by injuries when, we weren't.
Peaked at the right times of.
But all the guys, you know, were coming.
Yeah.
All the guys were coming through. It's just like when you know they won the Grand Slam. Everyone was pretty much fit for those campaigns, and it makes such a difference, especially for a team like Ireland or a country like Ireland who doesn't have 14 professional clubs or 12 professional clubs to spread around your talent.
It's really important for Wales and. Probably more than anyone else, Wales ourselves and Scotland more than anyone else, because of our small player base or small, you know, club base. England have a huge base.
Well, France, Scotland are particularly badly affected.
France have a strange base. But again, it comes down to, you know, to a certain extent, you might expect England to do something different when they play Wales. I don't expect Wales to do anything different than what they normally do. Like I said before, the problem is stopping it. It'd be interesting to see what England come up with. England are the team that kind of everyone expects now a bit of innovation or a bit of creativity from, because they're still very much an unknown quantity.
Well, they'll have Manu Tuilagi to bash holes in Jamie Roberts. And
the thing about Manu Tuilagi is, although he has the physical attributes to play that way and often does,
he's got hands like tits.
He doesn't really. I mean, when he's paired beside the right player. Like he was. Do you remember during the Lions tour into Australia, the game that Tuilagi and O'Driscoll played together, and they were wonderful together. Yeah. If he's played beside the right player, you can really take great advantage out of him.
Cutlass and the bludgeon.
Yeah.
Why not? But yeah, I would still argue that his hands are, well, he hasn't played in a good while now, and I haven't, to be fair, I haven't seen any of his games for Leicester. I don't see Premiership rugby. So he could be in super form. He could have done all the skills work and be a fabulous passer of the ball. But in previous years, he wasn't. He was good at running over people.
Offloading. Not so much. He was part of an England team where skills were not at a premium.
Possibly. So that leaves us France and Scotland, which could be a bit of an intriguing game as well. Scotland actually have a scrum. Amazingly, the two old grey boys in the engine room seems to have made a difference to them, or I don't know what it is that's made a difference to their scrum, possibly coaching, but they're not getting shoved all over the park, and there have been times in the past where, you know, they've lost to France. They had a few close games with France in the last few years, and they've lost to France like ourselves because the scrum fell over and France just ran over them. This time, they might hold their own. They don't have the depth that France have in terms of scrummaging props, but they might just be able to hold their own long enough to and I think it's in Scotland, isn't it?
Yeah.
So they might be able to hold their own enough just to run over France, which would be nice.
There's a growing realisation, certainly in the French media, maybe in the French rugby public as well, that the new dawn of French rugby that they were so happy about a couple of weeks ago was actually really just a PR dawn. Yeah, and it's a dawn of Northern European during the winter length in that it's over. I think that they've realized that this team hasn't actually come on at all really from the World Cup. Results have gone their way for one or two reasons, but when the chips are down, they're still
shite,
they're still as poor as they are, and I don't think they're ever going to get any better, to be honest with you.
Well, they were showing up for what they really are against Wales.
Yeah,
like Wales just toyed with them that game.
Yeah,
really.
Oh, they did. Yeah. I don't think that there's no France are.
If that had been Argentina instead of Wales, they would have put 50 points on them.
Yeah, they would have been ripped asunder.
But like even the try that North scored, like that, you know what I mean? That was just a comedy of
errors. Fairly basic, yeah.
Yeah, I don't. I still say that France are in serious trouble at international level.
I would agree. Hopefully, they're in enough trouble that Scotland can get.
Whether
past.
French rugby actually cares about that. That's a whole different
top 14 rugby certainly doesn't.
The public do. Yeah, no, that's fair enough. The public do care about it, actually.
I mean, like, rugby is played predominantly in the south, and they all travel up, like 80,000 for every international travel up, you know, and they're not afraid to let the team know if they're pissed off about it.
That's true.
You know, like, they won't travel across the water to come to a match in Dublin or to for a club game. You know, very
but
few
they will for an international.
They will for an international game.
And they're extremely. I mean, just socially, French are very patriotic people.
At most club games, they actually sing Marseillaise in international matches.
Their republics are about the same age.
Yeah, yeah.
Almost exactly.
They are very patriotic people. And so no, that's a fair point. The thing is, I don't know if certainly the top 14 couldn't care less about the international team. I mean, But they, like, don't seem to be, they don't seem to be going out of their way, no, or but even you, but you can vaguely
pretty,
to help.
But you can pretty much say that they don't in England either. You know,
no, they don't.
They're the only two leagues that the unions don't control.
I think that the English league are more inclined to work with the RFU.
That's because there's a deal.
Like, I know, but they are more inclined to do so. I don't think the top 14 has any interest in whatsoever in working with the FFR.
No, but and there's a lot of big, like, there are a few big owners in England that are kind of a bit portrayed as a little bit arrogant, but there's a lot of them in France.
Mm.
And they actively don't want the international side, international rugby, to take precedence. They actively want it to be like soccer, where the club game is paramount and the internationals are a nice distraction. What I would say with French rugby is there's too much of it. 14 teams, if everybody's got to play each other twice, 14 teams is too much. And there's too many international games probably as well.
Mm.
They could do with, you know, shaving an odd international game, and if you're going to play 14 or 16 teams in your competition, everybody doesn't have to play each other home and away. You can find another structure, either whether you go conference and have 18 teams, or whether you go, you know, what way you do it. You can have it where, like Super Rugby used to be, where you only play. You have so many home and so many away.
But they don't see it. The French clubs don't see it as a problem that the French national team is losing.
Yeah, that's what we're saying.
Exactly.
Yeah, I know that. Yeah, no, yeah. But like what John is saying, you know, they don't have a problem with the number of matches that are being played. They don't see it. Like, for instance, I remember, do you remember Johnny Wilkinson was going to go on a Lions tour?
Yeah.
And he
couldn't. Cause,
well, he did.
To play in the
eventually, he was playing in a final, I think, and he arrived 3 weeks late into the tour.
Yeah.
I think that the French people,
like,
the French,
they're happy with that. I mean,
the French public want the French team to win, but the French clubs are indifferent
to
the
play
French
a million
team.
Matches
yeah.
for
and
at 11
the
months
day,
of the year.
The people have to make the decision whether they want to, whether they're club men or whether they're Frenchmen.
But the thing is that, like, you know, when last year, there could have been 15,000 French came over for the match, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like, 15,000 don't turn up in Toulon. 15,000 don't turn up in Clermont.
Well, they just about do.
Okay, well,
that's the capacity of the ground, though.
Okay, in Clermont, but not in Toulon. Not in Toulon. In Toulouse, sometimes they play in their smaller ground. Just what I'm trying to say is that the clubs aren't getting 80,000 at their matches, like, say, Man United, Arsenal, and so on are. They're actually getting quite small crowds, not too dissimilar to what go to watch Irish clubs
mm-hmm.
or English clubs.
But
the amount of TV money that's coming in now makes it sustainable for them. However, the general punters that are going through the turnstile are actually not a big enough number to say, well, actually, this is the way it should be and there should be no international rugby.
That's true, but again, it's like you've just said, it's the money from the, like, look at the Super Rugby. You can't really have away fans unless they live in the other country. Because nobody's going to travel from New Zealand to South Africa for an away game.
You're
let's face
about,
it, for
the
weekend.
You're talking about a competition playing too many matches, it's that. Not Super, the Tri-Nations. I mean, they seem to just play each other all the time.
They do.
And, you know what I mean, there's no sense of occasion in those matches.
But there's big TV money, and that's what's sustaining that.
In fairness to the was the Tri Nations now Super, the, whatever they call it, the Rugby Championship, they've reduced the number of games they're playing against one another. I mean, at one point they were playing each other four times, was it?
No, it was only three.
Three times.
But
now there's.
But now it's just home and away.
It's just home and away.
It used to be three Bledisloe, man.
Yeah.
Just.
Well, there's still three Bledisloe games.
Yeah.
Yeah, which is.
But
one of them's usually in Hong Kong.
To bring it back to France. There's an element as well. I mean, we could have a situation where, you know, no matter how well French did win, lose, draw, whatever, that depending on things completely outside of his control, the coach loses his job because of a political shift.
Yeah.
You know, so you've got all sorts. I mean, the French team, the French international rugby team is a bit of a shambles.
Sadly.
You know, and it's a pity because we all grew up. One of the reasons why we all love rugby so much is because of the French team. Mm, I mean, the way it played during the 70s and 80s, it was just wonderful rugby. It's part of the reason why we love the game, why we love the way that Leinster play, which would have an element of that kind of French style to it. But, you know, that's dead. That's gone.
Exactly. All right, boys, thanks very much. Thanks very much for watching. Cheers.